Thank you, Saxon. Well, good evening to each of you tonight. Our song will be number 191. 191. We invite you to stand and we'll sing A Glorious Church. We'll sing the 1, 2, and 4, verse 1, 2, and 4. Do you hear them coming, brother? Thronging up the steps of life, clad in glorious shining garments, blood-washed garments pure and white. 'Tis a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb. 'Tis a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb. Do you hear the stirring anthems filling all the earth and sky? 'Tis a grand victorious army, lift its banner up on high. 'Tis a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb. 'Tis a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb. Wave the banner, shout his praises, for victory is nigh. We shall join our conquering Savior, we shall reign with him on
the blood of the Lamb. 'Tis a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb.
May we bow for this prayer. Like this, Brother Todd Wilkin, if he'll lead us, please.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we are thankful to be here tonight at the midweek service, and we're thankful that you have watched over us through this week, and we are thankful to be here in your house, and we are always thankful to be present within your church that you have established here. We are also very thankful that we have the outlets in which we do to be able to provide the word and the message to those who cannot get out. We know that your will is being accomplished, your word is being delivered, and we just pray that you would continue to be with the messages as they go forth. We know that there are many more opportunities for people to hear the gospel through our Facebook media, and we are also very grateful for the radio programs that we have and the ability that those have to spread the gospel as well. We do pray for our pastor who puts in the work to be able to bring forth those messages, and we are thankful that you have watched over him and blessed him with health. We pray for continued watch care over him as he leads us here at Faith Baptist Church. We ask that you would be with those members who cannot make it out. We pray for their circumstances, for those who have been mentioned for prayer, for healing that is needed, and for continued grace to be upon them. Watch over us tonight as we continue to study, Lord, in your word, and we pray that we would be touched by the lesson. We pray that you would guide our church always, help us in the steps that we need to take as Christians. And we pray that we would always be able to answer the call, and we always pray for the wisdom that you can grant. Forgive us of our many sins, for it is in Christ's name we do pray. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated.
I'm the Lord, I'm the Lord.
We gave you a couple of high-energy songs to kind of set the pace tonight. Good to see you. We'll be taking our lesson from 3 John, if you'd like to make preparation in your Bible. Is Linda still in the hospital, Glenn?
Yes, okay, she's doing a lot better today.
Doing a lot better. Okay, that's good news. Glad to hear that.
She had it pulled out within 6 hours. She's eating now, so she's doing okay.
Good, good. It makes you feel a little better too, don't it?
Yeah.
All right.
I'm just thinking today of prayer works.
Well, good, good. Give the Lord the glory. Well, I understand too that Andy Keaton Sr. is home, and so that's a progress report for him. So that doesn't mean everything's smooth, but keep both of them, Audrey and Andy, in your prayers, and others in our congregation that have ongoing health issues. Some of us just the fact that it's life, and others, of course, is more serious than that. I think that the times we're in can be very difficult because there's a lot of unknowns yet, and sometimes people make decisions, and we don't necessarily think that that's the right one that they should have made. But let's do this. Let's pray for each other and give open consideration for one another, because that'll have a positive effect. And rather than to grow critical or anything like that, well, I think that it would have a negative effect. So let's just use prayer and consideration for things that even we may think are not the way they ought to be, but just pray that God may reveal in his time and all may be responsive. We want to pray for the continuation of the church's ministries. Other churches are facing issues perhaps equal, if not greater, than ours. And so other churches need prayers, and we certainly need to pray for the national crisis that our country is in. It's not smooth sailing, but there's a lot of troubles that are there and will continue to be there. So a lot of prayer needed for those who are trying to do what's right. Well, we're in 3 John tonight in our study, and this is about the difference that upholding the truth makes. I think all of us are aware that we're tabernacled in human flesh. We know that through the wisdom of God and also experience, how that flesh can always be pulling us in a certain direction, and that direction may not necessarily be the way we should go. So we have to have a guard all the time about this, and especially to have a guard up to uphold the truth, no matter who would be involved with it. God says about human nature in Romans 8:7 that it's not subject to the law of God, the carnal mind, and neither indeed will be. And of course, Galatians 5 says it's always lusting against the spirit and the spirit against the flesh. So what do we have to work with? The truth of God. And it's our hope of spiritual success. As Christ said in John 8:32, ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. There is a gentleman mentioned here by name, and that is Gaius. And Gaius is mentioned about 3 times in the Bible. One of them is back in Acts chapter 19 and verse 29. And he was a companion with Paul in some of the work that was being done. So he's spoken of here as a well-beloved Gaius. John knew him well and evidently had a very close spiritual relationship and part in his ministry, as you see in the 4th verse. But what a wonderful thing can be said about a person, that they are a well-beloved Christian. God spoke of Daniel at one point and said, "Thou art greatly beloved." And we know what a wonderful character that Daniel was. In the first 8 verses of this chapter, of this book, we see the course that believing the truth affords us. And verse 1 says, "The elder unto the well-beloved Gaius, whom I love in the truth." A love for the truth definitely creates a bond with other people that love the truth and walk in the truth. Those are very common and a very strong interest. And 1 Corinthians 13:8 tells us that charity rejoices in truth. So wherever there is a love for the truth, there's going to be a love for those of the truth, and it's going to be strong. And I want to just go back into the book of John and notice a few things quickly that Christ had to say about this. In John chapter 13, and there in verse 1, in John 13, 1, "Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end." So this is all a love in the truth. Now you go down in the same chapter to verse 34 and 35. He says, "A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another, as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another." So it's an enduring love because it originates from God. It's not of the flesh or of circumstantial. It's not a product of circumstances. And then in John 14, 21, it says, "He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him." So this is a love that develops mutually with God and his obedient children. And then in chapter 15 and verse 9, "As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love." And in verse 12, "This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. And greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." So again, when you think about the origin of this love in the truth, it originates with God. And the truth and God, the author of it, is what gives it its character. In John chapter 17, and there in verse 23, John 17, 23, "I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them as thou hast loved me." Titus 1, 8 refers to this as a lover of good men. And that means that this love in the truth, it rises above envy. It rises above jealousy. It rises above resentment, because the truth is more important and greater than all of those. Now back in 3 John again, in verse 2, it says, "Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth." That gives you something to think about. There's a comparison kind of thrown out there, and that is, okay, how does my spiritual prosperity compare with my physical health? Is my physical health greater? So it's a challenge to us. But when you bring the truth into this picture that's being discussed, the truth nourishes the soul unto abounding spirituality, because the truth is of the power of God. And so what course would our health take if it was made relative to our spiritual condition? Would we be strong physically, or would we need help? Now in verse 3 and 4, we have living and walking by faith. "I rejoice greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee, even as thou walkest in the truth." The result of living and walking by faith is, of course, or let's say this, what produces living and walking by faith is a result of having embraced the truth. And this is done on an individual level. Anyone that's on track with the truth of God, they make a big difference in everything. They make a big difference in their home. They make a big difference in the church. And certainly it's very notable wherever they are. So the truth of God prospers the spiritual progress of those who believe in it. But somebody that's carnal-minded, they have to have something that's entertaining. They have to have something that appeals to them in the flesh. Otherwise, they're bored with just the truth itself. And then in verse 4, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. So what's that? The truth is a joy of those who are walking by faith. Faith denies self to seek unto and walk in the truth because of what? The hope and the consolation that there is in the truth and what the truth does afford a person. And you really have a confidence in people that are walking by faith, who are striving for that which is right with God. And you can have a lot of positive thoughts about their life and what they're doing. But an unconverted professor, and we know there are people like that. There are people that have knowledge. They know everything about how to be saved, but no evidence they've ever repented and been converted from self to the Lord. They don't experience the joy that's mentioned here. Rather, the truth is kind of distressful to them because it kind of puts a clamp on their style. Their style of just wanting to do their own thing and fulfill the lust of their flesh. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and there in verse 10 expresses it this way: with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved. So we have kind of an insight into unbelief in this verse. Unbelief is a rejection of the love for the truth because of a love for self and a love for the desires of the flesh. And then in verses 5 through 8, we see how that the truth creates fellow helpers in upholding the truth. Verse 5 says, "Beloved, thou doest faithfully whatsoever thou doest to the brethren and to strangers." So to know and have love for the truth, that not only is an individual thing, to where that a person is very glad they're saved and know that they are and rejoice in God's will and plan, but it also desires to promote other people who are doing likewise. Just so, let's read a few verses on this. We'll go to 2 Timothy chapter 1, and there in verse 16, we have just some mentions of other individuals. 2 Timothy 1:16, "The Lord give mercy unto the house of Onesiphorus, for oft he oft refreshed me and was not ashamed of my chain," talking about the fact that he was in bondage because he was being persecuted as a preacher. "But when he was in Rome, he sought me out very diligently and found me. The Lord grant unto him that he may find mercy of the Lord in that day, and in how many things he ministered unto me at Ephesus, thou knowest very well." So put yourself in Paul's place. Think about the fact, and we don't know, we might get there. If the Lord doesn't come and the Antichrist continues to march on the way he's going, he was in prison. He would never regain his freedom again. And he knew that God had already witnessed to him of what he was going to come to an end as far as giving his life. But here comes Onesiphorus. He looks Paul up. And he finds him and he refreshes him. He, you know, that would be just if you're in prison and nothing is there for you to do what you want to do, but somebody cares enough to come and see you. Somebody comes and prays with you and prays for you and does everything they can do on the other side of the bars for you. What an uplift that would be. That would be something that would certainly make a difference. Back in Philippians chapter 2, and there in verse 25, we have another man. Yet I suppose in Philippians 2:25, I suppose it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother, and companion in labor and fellow soldier, but your messenger and he that ministered to my wants, for he longed after you all and was full of heaviness because that ye had heard that he had been sick. For indeed he was sick nigh unto death. But God had mercy on him, and not on him only, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. I sent him therefore the more carefully, that when ye see him again, ye may rejoice, and that I may be the less sorrowful. Receive him therefore in the Lord with all gladness, and hold such in reputation. And here's the real verse that kind of is what we're looking for. Because for the work of Christ, he was nigh unto death, not regarding his life, to supply your lack of service toward me. You talk about someone that really had a mind for others. In the service of the Lord, you can see two men who really went the extra mile. In the fourth chapter of Galatians chapter 4, and there in verse 13, Paul said, ye know how through infirmity of the flesh I preached the gospel unto you at the first. And my temptation, which was in my flesh, ye despised not, nor rejected, but received me as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. Where is then the blessedness ye spake of? For I bear you record that if it had been possible, ye would have plucked out your own eyes and given them to me. Think about that, such a support that Paul had received in the past from these people at Galatia. It certainly was that which you could not buy with money, but it changed. And we're not going to go into the change, but sometimes people change. And so it did with them and him. Now back in verse 6 of 3 John, in 3 John in verse 6, which have borne witness of thy charity before the church, whom if thou bring forward on their journey after a godly sort, thou shalt do well. So here you have sharing the load of others by Christian hospitality. It's mentioned here after a godly sort, and that is recognizing it from God's standpoint and the way that God has set it forward to be practiced. I want to go over to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. This is just a reminder of what's being discussed here. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, after a godly sort, that is the way that God says it should be. And there in verse 13 of 1 Corinthians 9, it says, do ye not know that they which minister about holy things live of the things of the temple, and they which wait at the altar are partakers with the altar? Even so hath the Lord ordained that they which preach the gospel should live of the gospel. And then in 1 Timothy chapter 5 and verse 17, 1 Timothy chapter 5 and there in verse 17, let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in the word and doctrine. Concentrating on after a godly sort, I was not always a preacher. I know it was kind of amusing. Many, many years ago, down at Moore's Fork, there was a teacher that asked her students, and they were young students, who was the first Baptist preacher, and one of them said Brother Gardner, because he was the only one she had known in her lifetime. So I wasn't the first preacher. I wasn't always a preacher. And there was a time when I was just a member of the congregation. I was working and had my own job. But the subject of the preacher's income and the church pay would come up occasionally, not on a regular basis, but occasionally. And you know, it wasn't always with a godly sort. Sometimes it would be like everybody be having a good time, you know, talking good and enjoying the meeting. And somebody would mention about the preacher's salary. It would be just like if a skunk walked in the room and let forth his stink. Boy, everything would change. Everybody's attitude would go downhill. Not everybody, but a lot of people's would. And that's what God is emphasizing. When it comes to something that God has ordained, we're not to be peevish and resentful in our attitude toward it, but to be open-minded for it and to just let it work its way in the way that it should. But oftentimes that's not the case. And of course, it's not a good thing if it's not for the people involved. But I want to notice also in verse 5 of 3 John, it says, Whatsoever thou doest means it's not always big things. It's not always things that, you know, that you could write home about. But it's a combination of right things at the right time. And those can be so meaningful in just helping somebody. Don't have to be the preacher. It can be somebody else in the church that just has a need for somebody to lift them up. And just doing the right thing at the right time, well, that can make all the difference for them. So sharing the load. And we'll never lose by helping someone else. That's always going to be to our credit. And then in verse 7 of 3 John, because that for his name's sake they went forth, taking nothing of the Gentiles. Now, the emphasis here is for his name's sake. We are to think higher than just ourselves when it comes to what we're doing. We are to realize that it's the Lord's work, and what we do is going to reflect upon his work. So what we do should be according to him, according to the way the head would want it to be done. For his name's sake, they went forth. And I think, first of all, that's a monumental decision that only the individual can make with God themselves. It's not something that somebody else can make for them. Paul said that when God spoke to him and called him into the ministry, he said, immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. Nobody talked to him about it. Nobody tried to persuade him, but it was strictly between him and God. In Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 8, when God was speaking to Isaiah about a ministry that needed to go forth, he said, whom shall I send and who will go for us? And Isaiah said, here am I, send me. That again was a very individual response. And it doesn't matter if it's being called to preach or anything that God would have us to do. Why, that's something we have to do on our own, by our own faith. If we just do it because somebody else says we should do it, that's not really our own faith. That's not really our own response. Then it says, taking nothing. They went forth, taking nothing of the Gentiles. Do you read any place in the Bible where any of those who serve God went out and sought contributions from the world to be able to carry on the work that God gave them to do? Never. God's servants don't take from the world to do the Lord's work, but they trust in the Lord and God supplies. You can see that with Abraham back in the 14th chapter of Genesis, after he had been used of God for a great victory. And the king of Sodom said, well, I'll give you everything, all of the material things, and we'll just take our lives and our persons and go on. Abraham said, I won't take a thread or a shoe latchet from you. But because he said, if I do, you can say, I'm responsible for Abraham's success. And Abraham said, I won't do it. I've lifted up my hand to the Lord, and God will get the glory. So God's servants are not depending upon nor seeking the world's support to do the Lord's work. I don't know the guy's name offhand, but he was a very popular TV evangelist. He had a lot going for him. And at one point in time, he was putting his arms around the owner of a dog racetrack, a racetrack where they race dogs and they bet on them. And so that was a betting, gambling business. And this guy had made a lot of money, and he was donating that under this TV evangelist. And this TV evangelist was singing his praises because he was donating all that money. Well, when that's the case, the credit goes to the donor. And so when it comes to doing the Lord's work, if a church presents itself that we've got to have the world's money to do the Lord's work, then that means the work of God is not sufficient. And the world will then get all the credit. And the world will look down on it as something that depends upon me. And I'm the reason they can carry on. So taking nothing of the Gentiles, what we are to do what we do carefully, diligently, to get it all right for his name's sake, and to make sure that he can receive the glory, rather than an action determined by what is just suitable to ourselves. 1 Corinthians 10 tells us that whatsoever we do, we're to do it all for the glory of God. Now in verse 8, it says, we therefore ought to receive such that we might be fellow helpers to the truth. That's an important thing. Fellow helpers. Those who support God's servants are fellow helpers to the truth. So the ministry of a church is not one person, but 1 Corinthians chapter 12 says it's the whole body. It's the whole body, every member of the body. And the aiding, supporting, praying, working with, Christ is the head. And each one, it says, if one member suffer, all the members suffer. And if one, of course, is blessed, all the members are blessed. Do we think that way? Do we really think that the church's ministry depends upon us individually? That the preaching depends upon you as well as upon the preacher? Well, it does. And God tells us that we are to think that way of being a fellow helper. Then we get into some leaven that had gotten into the church. And in verse 9, Diotrephes. I wrote unto the church, but Diotrephes, who loveth to have the preeminence among them, received us not. So leaven is, in this case, was a person who wanted to be preeminent, who thought of himself as being a better mind, a better decision maker, and one that should be looked up to by all other people. 1 Peter chapter 5, and there in verse 5. 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 5 tells us, likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another, be clothed with humility. For God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. So we're to humble ourselves to where we are not clashing with one another. We're to be zealous for the spirit of fellowship. And people can get along when they respect one another to be humble with each other. You can get along. That's the way it works. But if a person thinks of themselves as ahead of everybody else, they're not going to get along. They're not going to get along. So any person of that caliber never seems to understand why they're not getting along. And the reason is They get upset when they don't have their way. And because they want preeminence, they're thinking they are deserving of that preeminence. So they won't accept it any other way. And that's what made Diotrephes have that attitude that he had. Now in verse 10, "Wherefore, if I come, I will remember his deeds which he doeth, prating against us with malicious words, and not content therewith. Neither doth he himself receive the brethren, and forbiddeth them that would, and casteth them out of the church." So he drew his own lines on everything, even not even considering some people worthy to be a part of the church. So his actions were marked. And that's what John said, they're marked. Going back to Romans chapter 16, in Romans chapter 16 and there in verse 17 and 18. Romans 16, 17 and 18. "Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple." So what Diotrephes was doing, John says, it won't be overlooked because it's a chosen course of action, not something over which that Diotrephes had no control over, but it was a choice he made. So our sympathy must not release anyone from bearing the responsibility that they themselves choose to do. Now, only repentance will make a needed change, and that will also bring forth fruits. Back in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, when God discusses the change that repentance makes, in 2 Corinthians 7, and notice here in verse 9, it says, "Now I rejoice not that ye were made sorry, but that ye sorrowed to repentance. For ye were made sorry after a godly manner, that ye might receive damage by us in nothing. For godly sorrow worketh repentance to salvation, not to be repented of. But the sorrow of the world worketh death. For behold this selfsame thing, that ye sorrowed after a godly sort, what carefulness it wrought in you. Yea, what clearing of yourselves, yea, what indignation, yea, what fear, yea, what vehement desire, yea, what zeal, yea, what revenge. In all things ye have approved yourselves to be clear in this matter." 1 Corinthians 4:2 says, "It's required in stewards that a man be found faithful." So God requires faithfulness in his business, and that's his work. Now, in verse 11 and 12, we see where that Christians are to be discreet and wise in all of our choices. It says, "Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. He that doeth good is of God, but he that doeth evil hath not seen God." So nobody's neutral. That's what the verse is telling us here. Like Christ said, "He that's not with me is against me. He that gathereth not scattereth abroad." So we must exercise our faith unto taking up our cross to follow the Lord. And it does lie within the reach of faith to do what is right with God. 1 Corinthians 10:13 says that there hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man, and God will with the temptation also make a way to escape that you may be able to bear it. 1 John 5:4 tells us that faith is a victory that overcometh the world. So he that doeth good is of God. Now we studied this on a number of occasions, but you go back to 1 John chapter 2 and there in verse 29, it says in 1 John 2:29, "If ye know that he is righteous, ye know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him." In chapter 3 and verse 10, "In this the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother." So it says that he that doeth evil hath not seen God. So doing contrary to God's will is a result of not looking to God in what a person's doing. And God is to be central in what we're looking at and what we're looking unto. Now we come to another gentleman here, Demetrius, in verse 12 of 3 John. Demetrius hath good report of all men and of the truth itself. Yea, and we also bear record, and ye know that our record is true. Here is a person with a purposed and a decided heart. And of course, that produces a good record. You know, God says a good name is to be rather chosen than riches. So a good testimony in what one is by the lives they live is essential to godliness and credibility. And what we are in real life should manifest a wholehearted belief and obedience to the Word of God. God says we're to be an example of the believer. And of course, Joshua said, choose you. But he said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. So what report are we writing in the mind of other people? It's not just about us. Because if it was just about us, God would just take us home. But we're left here for a reason. We're left here to be his witness. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 15 refers to the fact that we need to be writing a report of blamelessness, harmlessness, and without rebuke, to where that it is evident of who the lordship of our life is. Now in verse 13 and 14, the desire for fellowship. A desire for fellowship. I had many things to write, but I will not with ink and pen write unto thee. But I trust I shall shortly see thee, and we shall speak face to face. Peace be to thee. Our friends salute thee. Greet the friends by name. Those who believe the truth, and they feel blessed to have fellowship with other people who believe the truth. The closer we are to the truth in our hearts and minds, the closer we're going to be to others who are walking in the truth. We are to consider one another. Hebrews chapter 10, and we'll just go back and read that. These are not words that are to just be only idealistic, but practiced. In Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 22, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as a manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more, as ye see the day approaching. Christian fellowship has never been put on a convenience basis, but always on the basis of desire. Desire. Philippians 2:5 says that we're to have the mind of Christ when it comes to the application of ourselves to his work, to where we're not just wanting God's help, but we want what God wants in our life. So he says, greet the friends by name, highly esteem one another. And there are many places in the Bible when it talks about having that much respect for one another, to where they are highly esteemed. So we're to be earnest in our contending for the faith and fellowship. Fellowship, by definition, is being together and speaking face to face. As you see in 2 John 12, having many things to write unto you, I would not write with paper and ink, but I trust to come unto you and speak face to face, that our joy may be full. God designed Christianity to function in fellowship, so we must never fail to see how important it is. It is very important. We're to pray for it, we're to desire it, and then, of course, with the overall presentation of the chapter, how is our fellowship faring? How are we walking in the truth? Do we have the approval of our great physician? May we bow our heads for prayer at this time. Our Father, we do thank you tonight for your greatness and goodness and sacrificial giving so that we could be a partaker of your kingdom. And we pray that we'll cherish it and we'll honor it and honor those who are a part of it. And not to know one another after the flesh, but to know one another in the Lord. And we know there's no greater honor and no greater place that a person could have in this life than to be a child of God, in the will of God, serving in the body of Christ. And so we pray you'll help us to want to be fellow helpers, to want to be those that give that extra uplift as is needed, and to encourage and promote the work of God from a standpoint of individuals being the ones that carry the load. So we just ask that your Holy Spirit will lead us, direct us, and we pray that thy will be done. And we ask if you're speaking to anyone here tonight, that as we sing our song, we pray that there would be a response by faith. For it's in Jesus' name we offer our prayer. Amen.